I went to Summit High School, Summit, New Jersey, my hometown, upscale suburban town. A lot of the New York executives commuted, like my dad, an hour each way or more. And in those days, in high school, you had your choice. You could either take what they call the college prep course, this college, or a commercial course, which would prepare you for business, like over to Wall Street, get a job as a page in the stock market. I didn't, truthfully, very few people know this now. You might be one of the first. I wasn't going to go to college. I took the college prep and I did very good. I was liking 5% of my class. And then the summer before I graduated, two buddies of mine from Summit, Les White and Harry Fiedler, why would I remember them? That's, you know, came over to see me. They had gone to OU for 1 year and they were going back. And they bought a brochure from my university. And they knew I was interested in journalism. So I looked at it, and this school was supposed to have, even then, a good school of journalism. Well, I didn't even tell my folks. It sort of whet my appetite, see. And I didn't think I could get in because I didn't have the credentials. So there was a form or application there, whatever you call it, in the brochure. I filled it out, sent it in. I got the transcript for my grades from Summit High, which were impressive, but they weren't college. And lo and behold, I got a letter back. Now remember, this was the year in my senior going into college or work. And lo and behold, I get a letter back from the admissions office from Athens, Ohio, how are you? That they would accept me conditionally. I never heard of that before. See, I knew nothing about college. I knew nothing where Ohio was. I knew nothing about nothing or anything. And I got sort of perked up, and they said, however, you'll be required to take these courses, math, science, all that, history, English, the first 2 years before you can go into your major. Well, truthfully, Bob, I really didn't know what I was taking on. It was horrendous. Then I told my mother and father, could I go to college? I showed them the letter, could I afford it? Somehow, they worked it out. And this is an important thing in your story or presentation. I doubt if there ever was a student like myself going to college, not being prepared, not having a room, not having anything. This is a gospel truth. So my folks, we had gone to Europe in 1933, and this was 37, and we still had a steamer trunk from the ship. So my mother packed that and a suitcase. And the next town where the train went through was Elizabeth, New Jersey. And they saw me off, and I just had, just a seat. No club car, no up all night. With the rubber, straw seats. Go to Washington, D.C. About an hour or so change, I went out, looked all at the Capitol, and walked around. Then finally in that railroad, Ohio, whatever it is, that goes down through Pennsylvania, West Virginia, and finally Athens. Well, I didn't know. So anyway, I'm all alone. I did have enough money or sense to go to the dining car and have a real nice dinner. And you can't sleep on those things. Sat up all night, got to Athens about 5:30 in the morning. Now, and I don't know anything, nothing. Luckily, there was some delts with the automobile at the station. They were either meeting someone or rushing someone. At least I was smart enough to say, could you give me a ride uptown? the trunk I had to leave down. I took the suitcase, and I don't know why they didn't rush me. I don't know. Maybe I was not their type. But I left the suitcase at the Delt house. I walked right over to, in those days we had a dean of men and a dean of women. Voight, you heard a lot about the dean of women. Well, the dean of men was something, big, chubby guy. Dean Johnson was the dean of men. I went to his office. There was a great secretary there, young, good looking. And I told him my plight. I said, I just got in. I don't have a place to live, and this was Sunday. And school was going to start like Monday. Well, she was really great. She gave me a list of homes, starting closest to the campus, going out to East State Street. So I took this thing, and naturally I wanted to get as close to the campus, but, you know, day before, even though there were only about 3,200 students, maybe less, well, I got lucky. You know where the bookstore is over, where Logan's, you didn't know Logan's, you know, across from the other bookstore, next to Fred Clough's, there was a, Logan had the whole thing. Nice man, he, his wife, and his daughter, Phyllis, who went to OU. And then there was Quick's Drugstore, where every book, all the guys, girls hung out. And next to that, there were a couple independent homes, old homes. The first one I went to, what was the lady's name? Now, the lady had two grown daughters and a son who was in the assurance business, worked out of the home. He had one of those shingles. And I went over there, and there was one room right on the street coming up, you know, right there. But another guy from Brooklyn had taken half of it, and I could have the other half. Well, I didn't have much choice because it was a half a block, you know, from Court Street. So I took it. I never met the guy till late. I ran down, I walked down to the station, got my trunk, got a cab, came up, went in, unpacked everything. And finally this bozo comes in. You could tell he was from Brooklyn, New York, probably a really good academic, you know, B or A. But what a pain in the rump, I mean. And I knew immediately that we would not be friends, you know, it was going to be tough. And it was tough. Well, I had a place to live. Then I start walking around looking. And the next day we met at, it was a Memorial Auditorium then. I don't know, a test they give like for IQ or whatever it is. You know, it was in a big auditorium. And I did that. Then the signing in process, registering, was in the men's gym. Utter chaos, you know. You know, section by section, but you know, you have to go around. You know, what the hell did I know? What, you know? And you're young, they lay things on you that you have no interest in. But you also have very little to say. So I get in this thing, I'm telling you, and I never forget, there's a girl from Pontiac, Michigan, Jane Biggers, who you probably knew, Towner. She lived there for years, married there. And she was behind me or whatever. We went in and finally asked her for a date. We went over to Quick's for a Coke, you know. Well, I got a bunch of things and I looked at it. Well, even you, as a graduate student with a doctor's degree, you'd had a hell of a time with my curricula, whatever you call it, zoology, with a brilliant Dr. Crecker. That was for med students. The hell of a, you know, it was ridiculous. English, algebra. Crecker's course was my science. Well, Jesus, I registered and I started in, and there was no way that I could pass, you know, a course in zoology. Absolutely lost. I guess it's the same these days. If you got out of the class in 6 weeks and switched to, you know, they just dropped it, and I was going to get an F. I knew it. Well, that was my beginning. I don't want to take up too much time here, but the first year was tough. I thought I'd never see a C or a B. And that also doesn't help you, you know. Right around the corner, there was a Carl's restaurant where the business school is now, way up. And there were three guys there down. Why would I remember these names? I can't believe this. Harry Berge from Parkersburg, West Virginia. Ron Cowan from Lorraine. And an independent guy, nice guy, didn't know. They had a big room, three, and down the hall was a real narrow thing, you know, with a bathroom outside. That was available, so I grabbed that. So I got to go, you know, with these guys, because there's nothing for me to hang here. And they were Sigma Pi, and that is one of the things, eventually, that saved Richard O. Link. They said, how would you like to become a fraternity member? I said, I don't know anything about fraternity. I don't know if I can afford it. I said, well, come on. So they took me over to Sigma Pi. In those days, our house was fantastic, immaculate, well-run, because our counselor was Professor William H. Frenzel, who got to be very close to me, an Athens guy, you know, who went on. And they took me over there. And the first thing, these guys wanted to pledge me. I mean, this is early in the year, so I called my folks or wrote to them, could I afford it, you know. So they worked it out, and they said, okay. And I joined the fraternity as a pledge. Well, they had most organizations, a great standard, you know. You had to be at least a C, you know, to be initiated as a regular member. Well, I just didn't qualify. But I don't know, they wanted me. They didn't drop me. You couldn't move into the house anyway till you were sophomore. But I did take my meals there. I had all my meals there. Lunch and dinner every day for 5 days. One meal Saturday and one meal Sunday. Well, everything was good except what I was there for. And I was discouraged because, I don't know, just couldn't make it. I did all right. I got past history, and history and a couple of other things. The other things were zip. We went home the first Christmas, and I only was there from September. And I remember my mother was in bed resting, and I went in and actually cried and said, look, I can't make this, Mom. I can't make it. I'm going to drop out, and I'm going to go over the stock market. And I knew I'd get a job there as a pledge, because I had other, you know, good parts for me to as a future. So she said, don't do that, Dick. Or she called me Sonny. I was called Sonny in high school. I should have kept it. I would have made a fortune after the Godfather pictures, you know. Sonny Link. She said, I'll make a deal with you. You stay the rest of this year till June. And then if you feel this way, just call us, send home everything, you know, clothing, and you move in with us. They were still in New Jersey. Some of New Jersey at the time. So reluctantly I said, okay. I went back. The next quarter wasn't much. I mean, next half was a semester wasn't much. But somehow, I don't know why, I went back for my sophomore year. And I started, instead of zoology, I took geologies. Study, you know, rock formations as my science. I took algebra and passed, and I thought I was going to go right down the drain with geometry, really. You know, you're taking on something. You're not just taking, if I'd have taken my majors, I would have done well in journalism. Well, I don't know how I lasted two or three. My sophomore year. Well, it was a funny thing. I was well-liked for training guys like me. I got to know all the business people. I was one of those guys stopped in. They had a special student rate, you know, for groups, like 40, 50 more, you know, back east. So we had people from New Jersey, New York, Connecticut, you know, all over. So we made our own little party, you know, because you sit up all night, and boy, I'm telling you, it's cold in December, and it's no fun sitting up all night. So we used to take a blanket, a pillow, and then we started buying some whiskey, you know, like Lord Calvert's and Coke, and then we'd drink and have a party, because that's a murderous ride to sit up all night, you know. No stops for food, nothing, you know. And it got to be fun. A famous disc jockey in Cleveland, Ohio, in the record days, I traveled all over, got to be a good friend of mine, and I'd call on him, and he also did a weekend show at CBS in New York. He flew in for Saturday afternoon, and I had been visiting him in person, and I was going home to the Long Island, way out, East Norwich, Long Island, 32 miles out. Turn the radio on, and hear Bill Reynolds says, and yes, Dick, peripatetic Dick Link. I thought I had some kind of disease, so I ran home and got a dictionary, and I didn't know what that meant. Peripatetic Dick Link, because he was a fan of it. Then I looked it up and I read it. He's all over, traveled, does that, which was a real compliment. So that helped me. I've gotten to know all the merchants. I knew everybody. Even I remember Mr. Bush, who owned the paper, Kenneth's father, Jean Sprague's mother, who was a society editor, and she used to send me on weekends to do the dances and stuff. That part, I was a standout. And then I went home for my sophomore year, June. And don't ask me what happened. Maybe you can figure it out. You have a PhD. Something happened, a transformation. I don't know, it was maturity. I paid more attention. Because I was big for outside, you know, extracurricular. I was all over the world. And I caught on. Don't ask, I went through it, I still don't know. I start doing well in class. I was big in a fraternity, big all over, you know. I would say junior, because I knew then that I wasn't going to fail or flunk out. You know, when you come there as a freshman, Bob, and you're not equipped, you know, you're getting F's and D's like you want them. And boy, it's discouraging, you know, to put in a whole semester. And that's what worried me. So I guess I have to thank Ohio University and the faculty a lot for hanging in with me. I was, you know, I have other favorite schools. Duke is one of my favorites. Princeton is, Notre Dame is. But I didn't bother because I didn't think I could get in there. You know, who knows. But at least they hung in with me at Ohio U. I never once, which I expected, by the way, I never once received a letter at the fraternity house or back in New Jersey that unless, you know, your grades improve, we're going to have to, you know, drop you, you know, from our enrollment. And I thought I never got, not even one, I never got one. So I turned the whole thing around. I know who turned up, the good Lord at Ohio University. And then, like things you find out later, I had a lot of friends there, believe me, faculty too. I'll give you another incident. Mary Elizabeth Lasher, whose father was the director, I was 1 year ahead of her, she was in all the class with me. The toughest journalism course in those years was journalism and law. A students hated it. Some of them you couldn't hang. I happened to like law and understand law, and I got an A in the course. Not for asking for it. I did get an A. You know, and all this, a lot of people were worked to death, you know. But if I could have started Ohio University right into my major, I'd have done all right. But they accepted me conditionally, and that was it. And we stuck to that. I think this junior year made me feel like I belong. Then I did a very smart thing. I called my folks and said, I'm not coming home in the summer. I'm going to go to summer school between junior and senior year. And I'm going to take my journalism reporting, and I was all at the Messenger, reporting, editing there. And I took about eight credits or something. I'm thinking it was easy, which meant my senior year, oh my God, my second semester was like about 6 hours. And I really, really romped. And to end up this sad saga, on June 9th, 1941, I received my Bachelor of Science in Journalism. And I left campus to go back by that time. And my folks had moved to Forest Hills, which is a suburb of New York, a 20-minute suburb right in to the city. And I got my first job. I started August 13th, 1941, for the Associated Press, 50 Rockefeller Plaza. And there I am. The reason I took the AP job was I knew damn well I'd have to make some big contacts, and later on it would pay off. And you know that happened? But other than the AP, I wanted nothing. My second job was with a former newspaper man from Cleveland, Earl Ferris and Company, E-A-R-L-E-F-E-R-I-S. He had the largest public relations firm for radio shows. See, there was no television then. I went from the AP to, he happened to like me, hired me like this, gave me $50, I was making $25. I became one of his leg men. That was all radio. I met all radio stars, you know, big stars. And then, from there, I went to New Lemon. I started with Perry Como, 1944, the Chesterfield Supper Club radio. I got to know, you know, that New Lemon advertising agency, got to know Perry and Martin Block and everything. And then through politics, I wasn't set enough or know enough. I was edged out. Not through my fault. There was big politics going on. Chesterfield thing. I was brokenhearted. I was there 2 years and 2 months. Then a close friend of mine who's one of my mentor, Mike Nidorf, N-I-D-O-F, he was an agent, a theatrical agent, very successful, very sharp. He left and he managed Sammy Kay and Joe Stafford. So when I was out of work, luckily, a friend of mine who was Sammy Kay's advance man left to manage Don Cornell, who was with the band and going on his own. And Mike hired me as an advance man, which was tough, you know, going ahead of the band. But I got to know Sammy real well, and really difficult to work for, but we got to be friends, yes. As soon as he knew I was at Ohio U, it helped me, you know. But they hired me like in one day. And we got to be friends, and he did very well. Undoubtedly, one of the smartest decisions was to stay in school, you know, because if I dropped out, there was no certainty that I'd be a big success, you know. So naturally, that has to be one of the big decisions. The second decision would be, see, my folks were, you know, born in Europe, Germany and Vienna, my mother in Vienna, my father in Germany. They were real strict, you know. You know, Germans, I was brought up with discipline and respect. And you know, they were from the old school. You stay with the company 25 years. That was big then. You get your watch and stuff and leave. So when I wanted to leave AP, they were shocked. Oh, my God, were they shocked. And I think the second smartest was taking a leap into the unknown and going with her first, and then with Newell Emmett Advertising Agency, I was in charge of all the publicity for the Chesterfield Supper Club, Perry Como, Joe Stafford. That helped me, really helped me. And the third, brightest decisions had to be, see, I was well known in the record business. I was with Capitol twice, charge of promotion. 47 to 49 in New York City, 51 to 55 in New York City. And in the fall of 53, my boss, Hal Cook, was my age, and we were good friends. We both heard about Andy Griffith from different ways. He was down there, and our branch manager from Charlotte said, hey, there's a local hit record by a young guy named Andy Griffith. It's what it was football, you know, a monologue. That Saturday, I'm sitting in Forest Hills. My first wife and I, we got an apartment in my mother's building. Father, they were on the sixth floor. I think we were on the fourth floor. And I had been to Philadelphia the night before with Ray Anthony, the band leader, and his manager. So I didn't get home till about like 4 or 5 o'clock. At noon, I was having breakfast, and I had the radio on. And one of the big disc jockeys in New York was Freddie Robbins. Freddie Robbins was hip, you know, hip and new, but he had this NBC show, I forget what he called it, but what he did, he broke it down into segments, best singer, best group, best vocalist, best novelty, and then each week he would pick about 3 disc jockeys from around the country, see. So I'm sitting there and I'm listening to this talking record. And I'm reading the paper, and I said, listen, I said, this guy's pretty funny. I don't know who it was. And son of a gun at the end, he says who it was, where, Chapel Hill, Colonial Records. And it was in the novelty area. And goddamn, the three jockeys didn't vote, and he won in that area. So my boss was out of town, Hal Cook. I couldn't wait to see him. In the meantime, the branch manager took him to Chapel Hill to meet Andy Griffith and Orville Campbell, who owned Colonial Records. So he said, he's telling me and I'm telling you. So he said, we got to get down there. So Capitol home office was Hollywood, California. He talked the brass into, which they never would do. Sent us a check for $10,000, and we went down to Chapel Hill, flew down, it was in early December, met in a big, forget the name of the place, just Orville Campbell, myself, and Andy Griffith, with 2 different sets of contracts. One as Andy as a Capitol Records artist, and was one like the motion pictures do, where you hire them and own them service, and you guarantee them so much a year. And then at the end of the year, it goes against. And that's what we did. And Al said, you keep your job, Bill, but you oversee him on the side. I said, great, because Al knew I wanted to be a manager. And no pay, but, you know. I said, okay, Al, I'll do that. But at some stage of the game, it gets too heavy. I'll have to make a decision, either stay with Capitol, you know, or dump Andy Griffith, or go with Andy Griffith. Well, I handled it all, no one else. And we got lucky and things did all right. Yeah. And little by little, this is what happened. And the guys in the industry, the record industry and the music publishers, I knew them all. When they heard I was leaving Capitol to go with Andy, they thought I was nuts. I remember an incident. A really nice guy, music publisher. I used to take the train from New York to Jamaica, Syosset, called the North Shore. Well, I went on to Port Washington, Manhasset, and this guy lived past me. We were in the train, and he said, Dick, how can you leave Columbia to manage a hillbilly? I mean, Capitol. I said, do you want to know the truth? I said, because I see more than a hillbilly. I see a lot more. That's why. And that's what happened. Well, the state was capital. I'd have lost a lot. I'd have never made this kind of money, ever. Ever. Many nights I go to bed and I wake up like, you know, I go to bed early. I wake up at 11. My mind's going for the next hour. Yes. It's some journey because, hey, I've known A students. I've known degrees and, you know, masters like you with your doctorate and all the other people, you know. And I slipped through. I slipped through and I did all right. But there are three things, and maybe you can use this and get across. These three are the ultimate. They're not easy to get, but I credit myself. I was always honest, with integrity, and fiercely loyal. And I challenge anyone, you know, to downplay me on those three things. And I think also my mother, and a great deal to Ohio University, for giving me this chance. They don't know when I walk in, I'm a graduate of Ohio University. They don't buy my A, or, you know, BC. I can name some of my fraternity brothers, straight A's, great students. They did nothing like I did. So that's life. My mother, who didn't go past high school, had so many things she told me that, God, you think they came out of words or from a brilliant PhD. Little things like, and I'll break it down, and it's so true. One of them was, Dick, what you don't know won't hurt you. You know, meaning, if you have a Ford in an average class, you think that's the best car. Guy buys a Plymouth. Because what the hell does he know about a Lincoln or Cadillac? Doesn't know a goddamn thing, right? So what you have, you think is the greatest. And it really came in handy. So if you want to elevate yourself, that's up to you. Another one she had, oh, this really saved me many, many times. Because I was a good son. I wasn't your bad guy. I got to be crazy after college. She said to me, just do me one favor, please. Never do anything that your parents would be ashamed of. Now think about that for a while. And boy, that stopped me from a lot of things. You know, because I was honest again, integrity, loyal. I didn't want to go home and a cop brings me home to my mother, which happened many times to people, right? I didn't want to come up with a D, well, I don't know what it was called then, DUI. I didn't want to be locked up. I don't want to get in trouble. I don't want to steal. Really, that helped me more. She had many of those things. Many of those things. She said, choose your friends carefully, Dick. You're a bright young man, you know. Choose them carefully. Don't get mixed up with, you know, people you don't want to be with. And I did that too. Because I've dumped many people because they were borderline cases, you know, in college too. Who drank too much, who took drugs, you know. A lot of that stuff. It's like, that's why I've been a Yankee fan, also Dodgers, but Yankee fan all my life, because I saw them at an early age. And they have a saying that I think is number one. The reason you're such a great Yankee player, pride of ownership. Think about that. You're never going to do badly. You got to be proud what you're selling at Ohio U, right? What I'm selling with, you know, you believe in it. This is the best. This all came from words out of, like my mother. Fantastic. Don't drink too much. My father was a real sport, tipping like I am now. I tip like crazy. because I can afford it and I want to help someone else. He used to say, now don't be greedy, son. Instead of having that next drink or two, give that to the waiter. I learned that in high school. Don't gobble up, walk out, you know, leave nothing. These are things you should know as a young man.
Did your parents go to Athens for the graduation?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I have a picture somewhere. They were on the porch of Sigma Pi House. Because Roy Bierman from South Norwalk, Connecticut, he and I were very close. His folks came out, and we happened to all be sitting at the Sig House on the front porch there. And I had a picture of that, yeah.
So tell me about that day, the graduation day. Was that a big deal?
Yeah,
for you?
Well, it was a bit. Well, let me tell you, in those days, a lot of the teachers or professors, after the last exam, maybe the next day, 2 days, they would post everything on the door to their office. It was not like call, you know, alphabetically. And that you go, that's how I found out how I graduated. Looked down for Link, and I was thrilled. And then I felt like the BMOC, big man there. I did. Go up and down the Court Street, saying hello to the merchants and here and there. And then my best buddy in life, Richie Widder from Bayonne, who didn't go to college, he worked for Budweiser for 42 years as a district salesman. He came out with him, stayed with me, and we had a ball. It was an era, you know, it was an era of excitement. That can only happen like your first time going to New Orleans for the Mardi Gras, you know, or something like that. Or going to Vegas and somebody else picks up the whole tab, which I've had done many times. That's an air that you're not going to repeat, you know? So those last few days, my folks didn't come out, I don't think. Oh, that I think we graduated on a Sunday, you know, Memorial Auditorium, this entrance on this side, outside. And then that's where we went out Friday night, Saturday, and Richie stayed with me because my roommate, a great guy, Bob Arndt, A-R-N-D-T, from Palma, Ohio. He invited us to go up to his house after graduation for a couple of weeks. So my folks drove back to Summit. Richie stayed with me because there was nobody left in the fraternity. And we left Monday morning. And Bill Fenzel had that house right next to, you know, that blue house. The white and blue next to the Sig House. It's owned by a professor now, has been. And that was his home. And he and I were really like this. Well, I got to live with you. He came out to the house and we're all in the car, getting in the car. And awful feeling. You don't want to go. By that time, I wanted to stay back there, you know, really. Get a job in Athens. I don't know what I would do. Columbus. It was like empty road. Well, you can only take it so much, and I broke down and cried. Bob Arn, who also graduated with me, didn't say a word. My buddy didn't say a word. When we got outside toward the road to Columbus, you know, I simmered down, you know, and got control of myself and off to the races to Palmer, Ohio. True story. I wanted to be the graduation speaker. Now, because I've been through many of them, you get admirals, the dean of education we had several years, well, Bettina had them, you know? These guys talk about things that these people down there, they don't care about, you know? They're there. You know, what they need is a pumping up. And I said, you know, if I was ever asked to do that, I'd set it up there I'll tell you, by the time I'd finished, I would get aroused. I know it, because I would do just what I'm doing now. Now, cut it down, you know. Because there must be people who are going through this right there, who didn't have a lot of money, right? Who weren't well prepared. What's next? What's next? Well, I found out what was next. And all it took me a long time. You're talking, and I'm telling you, it's not bragging, I'm reporting now. You're talking about an individual I never knew who really, really made it. I'm talking in spades, you know, big, 60s, 70s, and 80s. So I did it. And don't you think they would like to know that it could be done from 25 a week to several million-dollar years for me, income, several? Even when I was on down, I never made less than $550 a year. Went from a million to $750 to $550. I don't think that's too bad. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. The guy that was supposed to flunk out. And that's why when they asked me to speak, and I've spoken a lot, but classes, you know, seminars, those big goddamn classes, you know, look, you know, down the hill, I always give this whole thing, and my closing line is, not too bad for a C student. And they love it. They love it. Everybody can't be an A student like you, right? A B student. I shouldn't have even graduated. But I did. And I said, I know I could turn around. I just feel it, you know, that I could get their attention. Because I'm speaking their language. When a guy sitting there like I did June 9, 41, or today, this June 9th or 8th, whatever it is, 2011, they don't care about what's happening in Libya. Seriously, they don't care. They have a whole new front. And I would set it up and say, now, you know what? You finished 4 years. You should be proud. You're graduating from one of the great educational institutions in America, our University of Athens, Ohio. But you know what? When this day is over, graduates, almost graduates, and you walk out with that diploma, you get your gifts, you get the hugs, you get the kisses, and you leave Athens, and you know what? You got to start all over. You're starting over like when you were a freshman, the first day. How am I going to do, right? And that's the test. But I would talk their language. They want to know, is it there? Can I do it, right? Now, I'm not talking about things like becoming a doctor, you know, or a CPA, or an attorney. Those are, you know, scheduled things. You either do it or you don't do it. Because that is the biggest thing. I'll never forget going to New York, boy. It's tough. And that's what they would like to know. They want, where do I fit in this scheme of life? And I would level with them. I would say, you know what? A certain percent of you are going to make it big. Some are going to be a little less, some are going to be a bust, and some are going to end up in an alley from drinking drugs. But that's life. Early in life. See, that's another thing I would get through at graduation. I don't know so much about today. Many of the students who attend Ohio, well, any college, they don't know what they want to do. You can't wait till your senior year and decide that you want to be a teacher or an attorney or even my business. So in high school, I was always a nut in sports and entertainment. That's all I cared about. But in those days, in sports, you couldn't make much money. And even in those days, being a youngster, my favorite color was green. And I like those bills with the pictures of presidents on. $50, $100, $500. I thought I'm going into entertainment because if I hit it, I'll do well. And that's what happened. But I knew what I wanted. See? Now, if we'd gone the other way, if I'd gone right to New York and stock market or whatever, I wouldn't have been in journalism, but I would have made it another way, you know, because I was anxious. Honest, I worked hard, you know, but that's how that happened. I knew what I wanted, and I preached to this mice when I taught. Right now, you know, stand around, What do you want to do? And if you don't know what you want to do, you better decide fast or get out of Ohio University. You can't wait till your junior, senior, decide you want to be a CPA, an attorney, a doctor. What? How are you going to do it? You see, you go as a bright young, you think you're a bright young man. What you are, a bright young man in your locale, New Jersey. But you're naive. You really have no worldly sense, you know. And then you go there, and you're in your old world, you're locked in academically, socially, it's a whole life, you know. And you don't care about the wars here, you know, a disaster here. You don't. You're worried about your own future. So I don't know. What I should have done was get a hold of, go out earlier, call them, tell them my plight, and could I get tutoring right away? You can't take a guy like me and throw geometry at him. You can't do it. I could be a genius and I could fail the course. You get the average say 16 hours, 32 a year times 4, right? And of the 16, just think of it, if you get 2 F's, 2 D's, you don't look like the hot shot from New Jersey. You might be mama's boy, but you're not the hot shot. So I don't know, truthfully, I might not have gone to school. I can't tell you how proud I was. I wasn't an A student. I think I was a C+, I don't know. Because the early years knocked me really out, you know. But I got my diploma. I got to love Athens, the school. And I swore that day that I would, I'd make another pitch to the graduating class too. Now you've had 4 great years. We call them 4 years of heaven. And you're going out. And please, don't forget Ohio University. Sign up as an alum right away. Don't wait. Come back, see your professors. They'd like to see you. Come back, let them know how you're doing. They'll use it in the periodicals, right? Stay in touch with the university. That's what I did. I may have except for a couple of people on the trustees, do you know that I made 55 homecomings? And that's not counting lately, that's before. I liked it, it was me. And I got better and better and better. And I don't know what you would call me academically, but I did make it.
You've given a very generous scholarship.
Yeah.
To journalism.
Well, that started.
So tell me, why did you do that, and what was
that started at Ohio U? As my getting to know, like, the names today would be you, Jack Ellis, the alumni director. I got to be very close to Marty Hecht. He was really great guy, the alumni guy. Later on, he went on lobbying in Columbus. He was really good. And he said, look, you're starting to do something. Why don't you think about OU and do something? And I said, yeah, that's nice. So that's when I came up. You ought to take a picture of that poster in my office, the first show.
I did.
Because I'll get you the date. I think it was 63 or something. And I said, I'd like to do something. That's what I got. And all those people I banished. Andy, Ronnie Schell, Tommy Leonetti, Ernie, and the girl, they're all mine. And we went back for nothing, you know. But we found out after they paid off everything, expenses, there wasn't anything left. So I said, I'm not going through this anymore. And I managed to come up with big pieces of money till I got what I wanted.